Despite all the publicity, despite the pleas of parents and actions by police, drunk drivers continue to terrorize our roads and highways. But much of that effort might be wasted on drunk drivers who are allowed to get back behind the wheel after they've been stopped once, twice, sometimes dozens of times. Roberta Baskin has an exclusive 7 Inside report tonight. Roberta?
Gail, we checked because statistics show that 1 out of 2 Americans will be involved in a drunk driving accident. We checked in Maryland, Virginia, and the District of Columbia and found that our legal system has failed to protect us. We found drunk drivers, repeat offenders, driving away from the courthouse minutes after their licenses had been revoked. The system has failed, but not because drunk drivers aren't being caught.
Let's try a different test, make it a little easier. Can you try to count backwards from 20 to 10?
This is a portable breath test. This cannot be used against you in court. This is a gauge to help me decide whether you're safe to drive on or not.
This is the part of the system with which we're most familiar and the part of the system which works the best.
Within the lane. He's still in the lane, but
state troopers and local police cruise roads and highways searching for suspicious behavior, hoping to stop a motorist who may have had too much to drink.
Right here, sir. I'm Officer Mitchell, D.C. police officer. This is a sobriety checkpoint.
Once in a while, they set up roadblocks, hoping the drunk driver will come to them. On this one night in the district, over an 8-hour period that extended well into the early morning, 36 motorists were caught driving drunk. 9 of them were repeat offenders. That's not surprising. The national average shows 1 in 3 drunk drivers have been caught before, abusing a system that can't stop them from drinking and driving again.
Let me ask you this question. Have you looked at Pennsylvania with their mandatory first-time imprisonment? Have you looked at Tennessee with their mandatory first-time imprisonment? Can anybody find me the state where the death rate's going down? Please, let me go there. I don't care what state of this union it is. Let me go there and find out, what are you folks doing?
The frustration is evident in Judge Vincent Famia. He hears more drunk driving cases than any other judge in Maryland.
But the fact of the matter is, death rates, maiming rates on the highway, I take as personal effronteries because I feel myself part of the system that's supposed to stop this. And we are not being effective. It's like busting your hump and failing all the time.
But why aren't judges effective? Why do they fail? Over a 4-month period, we investigated hundreds of drunk driving cases and found a system plagued with delaying tactics, plea bargains to lesser charges, and cases that simply vanished in the paperwork. But what surprised us most was what we found outside the courtroom. Carol Ann Riley has a suspended license for driving drunk. When she wanted her license reinstated, the judge refused. But that didn't stop her from getting in her car anyway and driving away from court. No one tried to stop her. We watched as Randy Coe of Arlington was able to walk into the district's office and easily obtain a D.C. license, even though he had lost his Virginia license to 3 drunk driving convictions. No one tried to stop him. George Macon, with 8 drunk driving convictions, isn't breaking the law by driving his lawn tractor, but Macon has been caught more than a dozen times illegally driving his car. Technically, he should have been treated as a felon starting 6 years ago, but hasn't been, apparently because his paperwork got lost.
Considered a DWR.
And Allan doesn't want us to use his real name or show his face because he's gotten off easy. He admits to 4 drunk driving convictions in Virginia and 3 in Florida. Yet for some reason in Fairfax County, Allan is now being treated as a first-time offender.
I guess it's the way the law works. And I guess the people felt I needed a break. Well, you know, everyone needs a break. But you know, where does it end?
Over the next few nights, we will hear more from Allan and others who have learned how easy it is to weave their way through the legal system. We'll also show you the type of tragedy that it can occur by allowing repeat offenders to remain behind the wheel. In the case of Randy Coe, who you saw obtain a D.C. driver's license, he did so at our request to test the system. We returned that license to the district, but later this week, you'll learn how he managed to obtain it in the first place. Gail and Meredith.
News 7 at 5.
They could be driving in the lane right next to you. Convicted drunk drivers who continue to beat the system. Good evening, everyone. I'm Paul Berry.
And I'm Susan King. Tonight, an exclusive 7 Inside report reveals major problems in the effort to keep drunk drivers off the road. Much of that effort is wasted on drunk drivers who are allowed back behind the wheel. And tonight, Roberta Baskin releases the results of her four-month investigation of those who are weaving around the law. Roberta?
Susan, as part of our investigation, we monitored hundreds of drunk driving cases in Virginia, Maryland, and the District. We found court systems riddled with plea bargains to lesser charges, delaying tactics, and cases that get lost in the paperwork. But what surprised us most was what we found outside the courtroom, drunk drivers weaving around the law.
Well, this Porsche guy, he's gonna be cool.
Whoa, watch out.
Dumb.
This home video captures a drunk driver weaving down the highway. It's only 8 o'clock in the morning.
Jeez! Seriously,
JJ, pass that little red car in the lane.
But prime time for drunk drivers is at night. That's when Montgomery County Police cruise Rockville Pike searching for trouble. Police do their job as best they can. One less drunk on the road could mean one more life saved.
Well, I'm placing you under arrest for driving while intoxicated and under the influence of alcohol, okay?
Being arrested for driving under the influence of alcohol.
At this point, you are under arrest for driving while intoxicated, okay?
But keeping the drunk off the road is a whole other matter.
I've arrested the same driver within 2 hours in the same night.
People who drink and drive tend to do it again and again. One in three of all drunk drivers who are stopped have been stopped before. They are called repeat offenders, and this man is one of them.
Are there any prior DWI convictions on the record?
Just the restriction being put on his license.
He'll end up in court, where he's been before.
I believe that the police arrest the drunk drivers in good faith, and first thing you know, he comes to court, and at 9:15 in the morning, it's let's make a deal time with the defense attorneys.
With the help of volunteers from the local chapters of MAD, Mothers Against Drunk Driving, we were able to monitor some 200 cases. Here's how some of them were resolved. In Montgomery County, James Brown, arrested for drunk driving for the second time, fined $25. Diane Darby, arrested three times for drunk driving, has received a string of continuances over a three-year period. Finally, she pled guilty and was rescheduled to appear for sentencing on another day. In Fairfax County, Douglas Deal, arrested for driving while intoxicated, pled guilty. His license was suspended for 6 months, but that didn't stop Deal from getting in his car and heading south for Tennessee. Denny Owens, arrested for drunk driving, pled guilty to reckless driving and had his license suspended for 90 days. Owens left court and drove away. Once he saw our camera, however, Owens became a passenger. And Carol Ann Riley, convicted on charges of drunk driving, went to court to try and get her suspended license reinstated. Request denied. That didn't stop Riley from getting behind the wheel of her car and driving right past the courthouse on her way home. Those convicted drunk drivers aren't the only ones we found weaving around the law. Others managed to escape because prosecutors failed to use one of their most powerful tools, the label of habitual offender, a label that makes the drunk driver's next offense a felony. When we caught up with George Macon of Oakton, Virginia, he was confining his driving to his front lawn. But with 8 DWI convictions and more than a dozen arrests for driving on a suspended license, Macon qualifies to be treated as a felon. But in 6 years, the legal paperwork has yet to catch up with him.
He should have gone to jail at least those three times, it seems to me, just looking at the record.
But why hasn't he been prosecuted by this office as a habitual offender?
Well, because no police officer has charged him as an habitual offender.
Our investigation in Fairfax County found the system works in favor of the habitual offenders. Last year, out of 373 drivers qualified for the habitual offender label, only 130 were found and processed. Allan should be considered a habitual offender, but after 7 drunk driving convictions, the courts are still treating him like a first-time offender. For that reason, he won't reveal his identity.
If the lawyer doesn't like the right prosecuting attorney judge combination, pull a rabbit out of the hat. Roll for a continuance. You know? It's like shooting craps. You roll the dice again. You don't like the combination, you try a different one.
Playing the game well costs money. Allan says his legal fees alone would have bought him a new Corvette. Somehow, despite all of his drunk driving convictions, Allan has never spent more than 2 days in jail, and he has managed to rack up safe driving points with no demerits on his driver's license. Tomorrow night, we'll look at some of the tragic consequences the victims of drunk drivers repeatedly weaving around the law. Paul and Susan?
Roberta, I am surprised. I have to admit, how can they just get out of the courtroom when they've been denied their license and drive away?
It surprised us initially. It's right under the prosecutors' noses and the judges and the cops and our cameras. But a statistic that is out there says that it's not so surprising. 70% of drunk drivers who have lost their licenses continue to drive.
And until the law tightens up and catches these people and puts them in jail, they're going to continue to drive.
Correct.
Well, this week, a special 7 Inside investigation is revealing major inadequacies in our legal system's ability to keep drunk drivers from weaving around the law. Plea bargains, continuances, and cases lost in the paperwork allow repeat offenders to drive drunk again and again, and to get away with it. Well, tonight, Roberta Baskin reports on those who have gotten away with it, and gotten away with it several times. In fact, according to Roberta, they've gotten away with it too many times. Roberta?
Paul, often repeat offenders aren't stopped until there is an accident and someone gets hurt. In the course of our 4-month investigation, we found 2 cases in particular that showed the court's inconsistencies in dealing with drunk drivers caught weaving around the law.
Kathy's headlights were coming toward us, and we knew immediately that we were going to be hit. Both my husband and I walked away from this car accident, realizing how lucky we were.
These photos reveal just how lucky. Mary Crane and her husband John had been driving home when they were hit head-on. John needed 20 stitches. Mary fractured her wrist and a vertebrae and still suffers back pain. 24-year-old Kathy Dolan of Fairfax County was charged with driving while intoxicated. Yet a month later, she was stopped again for drunk driving.
It absolutely frightens me that 30 days after she's involved in an accident that completely demolishes 2 cars, that she has the ability to get into another car and threaten somebody else's life.
Dolan declined to talk to us about her drunk driving record, 2 earlier charges of DWI reduced, and 3 drunk driving convictions. A confidential memo from an alcohol treatment counselor concludes prognosis for sobriety is poor. Under the law, Kathy Dolan should have been declared an habitual offender, making any future driving offense a felony. But that hasn't happened.
Perhaps because they can't find her.
Bob Horan is the Commonwealth attorney.
Unless you can find her and serve the papers on her, you can't declare her. And she must be declared in the locality of her residence.
But Kathy Dolan still lives in Fairfax County, and we had no trouble finding her. We also had no trouble finding 23-year-old Mark Winkler, a graduate of Sherwood High School near Olney. Winkler was described as partying weekends, cruising in Big Red, riding motorcycles, getting crazy with friends.
And I was just on my merry way. You do your thing, I'm gonna do mine, I'm gonna drink.
And drive.
And drive, correct.
Soon after he graduated from high school, Winkler was arrested twice for drunk driving, but he never made it to court.
When I missed a court date, it was no big deal to me.
There seemed to be no penalty.
No, I didn't care.
But soon after, while at college in Florida, Winkler drank and drove and was stopped again. This time it was too late. His car, traveling the wrong way on a highway ramp, collided head-on with a carload of co-eds. All 3 girls in the other car were killed. Winkler was tried and convicted of manslaughter, and at age 19 was sentenced to 41 years in prison, without possibility of parole for 20 years. Mark Winkler has now served 3 of those years in a prison outside Jacksonville.
You had 2 drunk driving incidents in Maryland. What if Maryland had thrown the book at you then?
If Maryland had have given me what the law required, then it would have wakened me up some. It would have let me realize what was going on.
Are you sorry that you got away with it?
Yeah. Yeah. Because if I had stayed, and if I had done accepted my time, No, this would not have happened.
Only after the state of Florida put Mark Winkler in prison for 41 years did Maryland act. He was extradited back here and given the maximum sentence for his two drunk driving offenses here, a year and 60 days to be served concurrently in Florida. And tomorrow night we'll show you another problem with the system, how easy it is for drunk drivers with suspended licenses just to cross the Potomac and get another one.
When you were in conversation, Roberta, with Robert Horan about this problem, what was your sense of his concern about this business of drunk driving? I mean, he's got murders and robberies and all kinds of things to prosecute. Where does drunk driving fit on the totem pole?
It is certainly not as high a priority as murders and other kinds of things, but as you see, drunk driving can turn into a murder because drunk drivers, when they get behind the wheel, don't know what they're doing and you get victims. And it seems that the courts really, in most cases that we looked at, don't take this problem seriously with repeat offenders until there are victims involved, until there's a tragedy. And many of the repeat offenders that we talked to had 6-7 DWI said, we wish that we had been treated more severely sooner.
This week, an exclusive 7 Inside investigation is showing how a lax legal system allows drunk drivers to get behind the wheel time and time again. Tonight, Roberta Baskin reveals how drunk drivers are weaving around the law. Roberta?
Renee, if your driver's license is revoked or suspended in one jurisdiction, you shouldn't be allowed to obtain a driver's license in another. But what's to stop you? The motor vehicle system should. Yet we talked to a number of convicted drunk drivers who lost their license in one place and obtained another simply by applying somewhere else. It had been just another bustling Friday afternoon until an out-of-control delivery truck tore a path of destruction through the intersection of 16th and K. The truck plowed into a dozen vehicles and 5 utility poles. One woman who had jumped from her car trying to escape was run over and seriously injured. The terror stopped only after an angry crowd pulled the truck's driver from its cab and wrestled him to the ground.
And it took about 6 men holding him, and they were like holding him down as best as they could, but he was just like a lion. He was just crazed, like he was on drugs or something.
I'm sorry, whatever. It's an accident, and I've said that before. That's all I got to say.
Police reported 43-year-old Jerome Green had been legally drunk. In fact, Green had had a long history of trouble behind the wheel, including 72 suspensions of his New York driver's license. But despite his driving record, Green was able to obtain a D.C. license. Larry Greenberg, chief of the district's Motor Vehicle Bureau, would not comment on the Green case, but said all efforts are made to check the driving records of all license applicants.
I am concerned about anyone having a driver's license that has been suspended or revoked in any jurisdiction. Certainly, we are doing everything in our power to reduce that.
31-year-old Randy Coe of Arlington falls into that category. After 4 drunk driving convictions, his Virginia driver's license is revoked. Coe rides the Metro these days and now understands the chances he took driving drunk.
Why did I drive? I thought I could get away with it. And by having a couple of beers and getting under the influence, it puts you in another world sometimes and you think, well, I can get away with it. And unfortunately, I didn't.
Coe shouldn't be able to get a driver's license in the district, so we asked him to test the system. He immediately obtained a learner's permit and scheduled a road test. He passed his road test, paid his fee, and in no time at all, Randy Coe of Arlington, Virginia, had easily obtained a brand new District of Columbia driver's license. We took the results of our system test to Motor Vehicle Chief Larry Greenberg.
If the violation didn't take place in the District of Columbia, we would have no way in knowing whether he was suspended or revoked in Virginia. What we would have to do is check with the National Driver Register.
The National Driver Register is a network of driving records from all over the country. It's located here at the Federal Department of Transportation just 7 blocks away. Some states can get the information in just 6 seconds, but in the case of Randy Coe, it took the district 6 weeks to process his driving record.
One of the things we're doing to shore up that crack is that eventually we'll have a system where we'll be communicating directly with the NDR.
Right now, there are 9 states that run instant background checks on driver's license applicants through the NDR. Within a year, the district hopes to be added to that list. Meanwhile, Randy Coe does not drive, but looks forward to the day that he can legally get his license back. Tomorrow, we'll look at solutions to the problem of drunk drivers weaving around the law. Renee and Paul?
Roberta, in light of what we've just seen, how effective really are license revocations as a way to control this problem?
Well, people want to drive, and if they have their license revoked, they're upset about it, and 70%, up to 70%, will continue to drive. And yet the National Transportation Safety Board says that it's still a very effective enforcement tool because they're going to drive more cautiously because they don't want to be caught.
Well, all this week, an exclusive 7 Inside report has revealed how lax procedures in our legal system allows drunk drivers to weave around the law. Roberta Baskin has exposed some of the problems. She joins us now with some possible solutions. Roberta, what can you tell us?
Well, Paul, the National Commission Against Drunk Driving ranks Maryland and Virginia among the bottom 5 states in their efforts to stop drunk drivers. There are some methods that have proven successful and others that are still being tested. However, all seem underutilized in our area. David Dent is a computer programmer by day, under guard by night. He's been convicted of drunk driving 4 times, enough violations to land him here in the DWI facility in Prince George's County. Security is tight, and breath tests are routine.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
But there is also treatment, intense alcohol counseling every day.
I know I got a problem. Admitting it's one thing, doing something about it was another, and that's why I'm here.
The DWI facility is one option judges have when sentencing someone convicted of drunk driving. If not here, they could end up across the street in prison. And that option has a sobering effect on drunk drivers.
I think sending people with DWIs to this facility rather than jail, your odds are better of them getting better. You couldn't convince me otherwise.
But when we visited this 60-bed facility, it was only 2/3 full, and there certainly is no shortage of drunk drivers in PG County. The same is true in Virginia, where a similar facility in Fairfax County was only half full. However, some judges, like Vincent Famia, believe treatment facilities are a limited option.
If it's called for, you use it. If it's not called for, you don't use it. And if the facility doesn't fill up because not enough judges think it's called for, well, that's the way it goes.
Right behind this vehicle, sir.
Police use a more direct method in dealing with drunk drivers, roadblocks. In the district, they are used sparingly, but still more often than in Maryland and Virginia. On this particular Friday night, 36 drunk drivers were arrested. 9 turned out to be repeat offenders. What do you think about the sobriety checkpoint?
Like I said, I think it's degrading. I mean, that's the worst thing I ever come in contact with.
Have you ever been arrested for drunk driving before?
No.
However, we checked Stephen Broadway's driving record and found he had been arrested before for drunk driving and was driving on a revoked license. These midnight roadblocks have proven to be one of the most effective ways of stopping drunk drivers. But tomorrow night, this roadblock will be gone, and chances are there will be just as many drunk drivers back on this road. But that's not the case down under. In Australia, roadblocks are routine. 1 in 3 motorists here can expect to be stopped at least once a year. And that threat alone is credited with drastically reducing the number of drunk driving fatalities. One of the more intriguing methods of stopping drunk drivers is by not allowing them to start their car, that is. Now, if you're convicted of drunk driving in any one of 13 states, the judge can order you to use this electronic gizmo called an interlock. It's basically a breathalyzer. Blow in too much alcohol and your car won't start. Just ask Edward Gross.
The mere fact that I knew that I couldn't start my car and I needed my car, that really, you know, that bedeviled me. I thought, holy smokes, you know, I can't drink anymore.
They could lie to the judge, and they could lie to the probation officer, and they could lie to their alcohol counselor, but you can't lie to an interlock in your car.
But only a dozen or so judges now use this option.
The trouble is, the first one I offered said, nah, I'd rather be revoked.
However, it's important that one or all of these options be used to prevent drunk drivers from drinking and driving again. One graduate of the DWI facility, David Powell, says he had to almost beg the courts to stop him from driving drunk. And that was after 6 DWI convictions. Up until then, the courts had taken little action against him.
If someone continues and continues to drink,
and drive. The odds of you killing someone are astronomical now. I think in the long run, after the second time of giving me a chance, you know, they'd probably been better off taking me off the streets completely.
Another drunk driving offender that we profiled this week just had a serious car accident. He's in the hospital now with broken ribs, but there are also victims because he hit another car head-on, and he was driving under the influence. His record includes half a dozen DWI convictions, yet he got first offender treatment on the last one. That kind of treatment isn't a favor to him or to other motorists. And one final thought. Alcohol limits are set by politicians, but they do not accurately measure a driver's real impairment. Studies show that just one or two drinks will impair you. So for safety's sake, don't mix drinking and driving.